Welcome to Peninsula Seniors Lecture Series. Sit back, get comfortable, and let's go see what they have for us today.
Good morning. My name is Leanne. I'm the lecture coordinator for the Peninsula Seniors. Today we have Dana Graham joining us. Dana is a realtor and historian, and Dana will be sharing with us the other reasons why Japan lost the war.
I'm sure some of you remember the announcement. We interrupt this program to bring you a special bulletin. I missed it by a couple of years, but this discussion is not a chronology of the battles. It's not a chronology of the war. I'm going to discuss a couple of the battles, but it is the unappreciated or undiscussed reasons that Japan lost the war. I've seen no book on this subject. This is something you kind of have to study the war, which I've done for 40 years, to sort of figure out the things that Japan did to kind of shoot themselves in the foot that they didn't have to do, but that hastened their demise. The roots of Japan's involvement in World War II go back to 1600, when the Tokugawas took over. They called it the Tokugawa Shogunate, and they kicked out all the Europeans out of Japan. They wanted to avoid foreign influence, which they thought was going to corrupt the Japanese culture, which they viewed to be pure. And so they kicked out the Jesuit missionaries, the Dutch traders, and all those kind of people that were in Japan at the time. And that lasted until 1853. You see how fast we got through the first 250 years? I mean, it's amazing. But in 1853, Admiral Perry, or Commodore Perry at the time, came into Nagasaki Harbor on the USS Wyoming. The Europeans had been sort of having their way with China for a few years prior to that, you know, the Opium Wars and all that sort of stuff that the English had the Opium War they had with China. And the Japanese were watching that. Well, up shows Commodore Perry in Nagasaki with the USS Wyoming, and who at the point of the guns of the USS Wyoming extracts trade concessions out of the Japanese. The Japanese had fallen way behind the West technologically during the 250 years of their isolation, and they had no way to resist this. And so this was a wake-up call for them. In 1868, they got rid of the Tokugawa Shogunate and put the Emperor Meiji on the throne. It's called the Meiji Restoration. And his job, or the job of the Meiji Restoration, was to get the Japanese up to speed militarily, industrially, technologically, and all that, because they realized that there was no way that they could resist the West without that. In the late 19th century, an island nation's power was determined largely by its navy. I think that's probably generally true. But there was an obscure naval captain named Alfred Thayer Mahan who wrote a treatise called The Influence of Sea Power on History, where he went back for the previous 250 or so years and proved that they that controlled the oceans controlled their own destiny. The Japanese were an avid reader and avid student of that. So the Meiji period was one of rapid industrialization. By 1894, the Japanese needed raw materials to sustain this industrialization. The Japanese famously have very few raw resources in their islands. And so they needed colonies. They needed some way to sustain their industrialization. So they invaded China, 1894 and 95. The fight was basically over Korea. They easily defeated China. 1904, 1905 was the famous Russo-Japanese War. And this really got the world's attention. The Japanese defeated the Russians rather handily. The war basically consisted of two naval battles, Port Arthur and Tsushima Strait. And Russia at the time was considered to be a pretty major power. And it wasn't. It was kind of decrepit, but nobody sort of realized it at the time. And so that kind of put Japan on the map. So we get up to World War I. The Japanese were on the side of the Allies in World War I. They thought that if they were on the winning side, they should have got some pretty good spoils of war. Well, all they basically got were the former German mandates, the Carolines, the Gilberts, and the Marianas, and some territory in the East Indies. That was all they got as a result of their involvement in World War I. Now, in all honesty, their involvement in World War I was pretty minor. But they that was all they got, and they kind of got a chip on their shoulder. And the chip was made bigger in 1921 when there was what was called the London Naval Conference. London Naval Conference was one of the first arms limitation conferences. There had been a naval arms race starting in 1905 when England had launched the Dreadnought, which was the first battleship as we know it today. It was the first battleship. And all the European powers decided, well, we got to have these too. So there was a big naval arms race, which by 1921, the European powers had decided had contributed to World War I. And so the result of the London Naval Conference was that a ratio of 5 for the Americans, 5 for the British, 3 for the Japanese, and 1 3/4 each for Italy and France would be the limits of what they could build in the way of capital ships, by which I mean heavy cruisers and battleships. Aircraft carriers were not considered. They were not, by 1921, an aircraft carrier barely existed. And so what that meant was that the United States could have a total of 525,000 tons of displacement of capital ships between battleships and heavy cruisers. The cruisers were limited to 10,000 tons. When you hear the term treaty class cruiser, they're referring to the Washington Naval Treaty. 10,000 ton maximum displacement, which the United States had a lot of those by World War II. So Japan was miffed that they only got a ratio of 5 to 3. The idea, of course, was that England and the United States had worldwide interests that they had to protect, whereas the Japanese were mostly a Far Eastern power. Even though they had other ambitions, they were only a Far Eastern power. But Japan was not happy with that. In 1930 was the London Naval Conference. London Naval Conference was meant to extend the Washington Naval Conference, which was a 10-year length of time. Basically, those ratios and those limits were reaffirmed at the London Naval Conference. And so Japan had that shoved down her throat, and they were, by this time, they were really upset. So what happened was that the Navy, the Japanese Navy, which was certainly the most significant naval or most significant military power in Japan, got divided into the treaty faction and the fleet faction. All right, the treaty faction thought that they ought to negotiate to get their aims. The fleet faction thought they had a fight, that negotiation wasn't working, and that the London Naval Conference was the last straw, and that they ought to. And so the Navy got divided that way. Admiral Yamamoto, who everybody's heard of, I presume, was a member of the treaty faction. He's the guy that planned the attack on Pearl Harbor. He's not the one that carried it out, contrary to popular belief, but he is the one that planned it. But he had lived in the United States in the early 20s. He went to Yale, and he knew that Japan could not possibly compete with the United States in an industrial war, and so he thought there's no point in fighting the United States. There's no way we can win. We may as well negotiate. But when a decision was made to go to war with the United States, like a good soldier, he went ahead and carried it out. In 1931, right after, you'll notice, right after the London Naval Conference, Japan invaded China. This was the Kwantung Army, the famous Kwantung Army, of which General Tojo, later Premier Tojo, General Tojo was the commander. This is where he made his reputation. This is where the Rape of Nanking happened. This is where the Panay, the American gunboat, sank on the Yangtze River in 1937. The Kwantung Army ran basically the Americans out of China. In fact, one of the founders of Neighborhood Church, if you're familiar with Neighborhood Church, was a missionary in China and was chased out of China by the Kwantung Army, which is kind of interesting, Dennis and Hazel Smith. But anyway, the Kwantung Army and all the atrocities with the babies being bayoneted and all that stuff happened under their auspices. So the United States had a lot of interest in China and in the Far East generally, and we're trying to get the Japanese out of China. And get them to go back to negotiating and not be quite so aggressive. So in 1940, the United States embargoed oil to Japan. Japan got 80% of its oil from the United States. So this was a problem for Japan. At the time Pearl Harbor was attacked, Japan had a 18-month supply of oil to conduct the war. So they needed a really fast victory or they were going to be in trouble. As you know, they didn't get a fast victory, and the rest is history. But there were a few things that Japan did that they didn't really need to do that contributed to their defeat. And this is what I want to talk about today. Understanding there's no way that Japan could have won under any conditions. Just the order in which it sort of occurred to me 7 years ago. The first is Bushido. Bushido was a holdover from the samurai period. This was a Japanese warrior code. And the warrior code dictated that you fight to the death, you never surrender. All right, and this is good kind of as far as it goes. You fight to the death at maximum effort. You don't surrender. You don't get taken prisoner and shame your ancestors or your family. The bad news with that is that during the course of the war, being willing to die kind of morphed into being anxious to die. And there were horrendous Japanese casualties. And the reason was that the Japanese had the idea that the appearance of how they died, in other words, they had to die gloriously in battle. They could not die any other way, and they certainly couldn't surrender. And so this aided the recruitment for the bonsai charges. And the Japanese would charge into emplaced machine guns, and I've got a few examples of this in a minute, knowing that they were all going to be wiped out. They knew they were going to be wiped out. But it was more important to them to die gloriously rather than to shame their family and go back to Japan and later having surrendered. That was absolutely unthinkable. So the bottom line is the appearance kind of trumped the result. There's a couple of sort of underlying themes that occur to me when I study this. One is that the Japanese appear never to have been seriously tested in battle. And this is true, by the way, in their modern history. They won handily over the Chinese. They won handily over the Russians. World War I wasn't a big challenge for them. And this lack of really being tested carried through to their strategy, carried through to the design of their hardware, both their ships, their guns, their tanks, everything. It carried through to that. And kind of related to that is that there seemed to be an underlying assumption that nobody competent was going to be shooting back at them. Right? And I'll go through how that manifested itself. But it just seemed like it didn't occur to them that the enemy was actually going to be shooting back. And so they devised all of these war plans and all of the ships and all this different stuff that seemed to have that implicit assumption. So here's a bonsai charge. There aren't too many pictures of bonsai charges, needless to say. They usually took place at night. The bonsai charge typically was took place once the Americans had landed on the island. The bonsai charge was an attempt by the Japanese to drive the landing force back into the water. This was typically when the bonsai charges took place. So they typically took place the first night after the landing took place. There were other ones that were later, especially on Saipan, but typically that's when they took place. So therefore they were at night. So you didn't exactly get the Klieg lights out and, you know, film the bonsai charge. I mean, it didn't happen. So here's a rare picture of a bonsai charge here. And below is the normal result, which are the bodies piled up. The bonsai charges typically resulted in 100% or close to it casualties, which as the war went on, the Japanese were willing to do for reasons I just mentioned. They wanted to die gloriously in battle. So this was all part of the Bushido code. And it didn't really serve the Japanese well. The problem was that they all died. And so nobody could go back and tell the remaining officers what might work better. Another aspect of Bushido was, and you've seen the poignant films of the mothers throwing their babies off of the cliffs onto the rocks, the Chamorros jumping off, the Japanese civilians jumping off. Marpy Point's the most famous location for this. There were also the suicide cliffs on Okinawa and on Tinian. My wife and I, 10 years ago, were on a wonderful cruise, which my wife absolutely loved, to all the South Seas battle sites. And I throw this picture in just to remind her of some of the places that she's been that no one else has been. Here is Marpy Point. This is exactly where those black and white newsreels were taken, where the people were jumping off the cliffs and all that. And the reason this is interesting to me, apart from illustrating the Bushido, that what they were willing to go through, they don't show this in the newsreels. The Japanese army's right behind the people that are going to commit suicide with their bayonets, okay? And they're driving them off. They had told the Chamorros and told the civilians Americans are going to rape them, eat them, torture them, whatever heck they told them that they were going to do. And so they herded them off the cliff. But there is one of the newsreels where the camera pans around to the right. It actually is standing on the other side, and it's panning to the left. But anyway, it pans out to the ocean, and it shows this LST 400 yards offshore. You know what LST is? Landing ship tank. It's a 365 foot, I believe it was. Anyway, it's a ocean-going landing ship. And there's a guy on there with a bullhorn. And he's talking to him, and you can't hear him, there's no sound. But I happen to know he's talking to him in Japanese. He's talking to him in Japanese, tell him not to jump. And talking to him in the Chamorro language. This is my father, okay, when it shows him. This is my father. He's hiding behind a 40-millimeter gun mount, okay, on this LST. He's hiding behind, because Japanese are firing at him. Okay, they're firing at him. And so he jumps behind a gun mount, and then he jumps back out and goes, don't jump, don't jump. And he goes behind a gun mount like that. And he got the Bronze Star for it, which is not any huge deal. But it was kind of an interesting thing. And like I say, there is one of the newsreels that actually shows that ship out there. And if you know where to look, you can see my dad, doing that. He did the same thing on Tinian. He's trying to talk him out of jumping and telling him where the American lines were, so that they could go and surrender to the Americans. On the subject of offense, one of the ways the Japanese shot themselves in the foot was that their battle plans were incredibly complicated. They kind of assumed that nobody competent was going to be shooting back at them, and that the enemy was going to do exactly what the Japanese want them to do. Now Moltke, if they'd have read Moltke, Moltke said no battle plan survives contact with the enemy. I mean, this is one of the famous dictums of military history. No battle plan survives contact with the enemy. Well, the Japanese didn't read that part of it, because they assumed that the Americans were going to do exactly what they thought. And so here's the Battle of Leyte Gulf, just as an example. And so you got Nishimura, the red lines are the Japanese, the black lines are the Americans. On the bottom, you've got Nishimura with the old battleships come up here. This right here in the middle, lower middle, is the landing beaches. You know where MacArthur was filmed going ashore later? That was a stage deal, the one you see. But this was the actual one. So here are the Americans trying to land. And then you got Nishimura coming up with the old battleships. You got Shima coming through with some cruisers and a couple more battleships. You got Kurita coming through with the Yamato, which is the famous Japanese battleship, the huge one, and all these heavy cruisers. And then you got Ozawa up here. Now, this is 1944 by now. Okay, these names probably don't mean anything to you. These are Japanese admirals that were still around and hadn't committed hara-kiri or nothing by then. And the idea was to lure the American fleet away. This fleet was under Halsey, to lure them away. He had all the carriers. Lure them up here. The Japanese carriers, by this stage of the war, had no planes left on them. Okay, I told you this is not chronological, but by this time, mid-44, the Japanese had lost their naval air arm, basically, for reasons that we'll talk about in a second. But they were trying to lure Halsey, who they figured didn't know that, lure him up here to get him away from guarding the beaches. And so that succeeds. Halsey falls for it. And this is a famous thing, where is Task Force 38, the world wonders. So Halsey, Task Force 38, goes up here and chases Ozawa with the empty carriers. And then these three forces here all have a chance to come in and destroy the landing beaches. But Nishimura's old battleships got sunk on the way. You can see the American planes right here, the little black ones, they basically attacked them. Same thing with Shima's force, which was coming through the same place. Kurita, this is the famous battle where you see Kurita coming, where Kurita came around the bend right here, and the American landings are here, and there were the baby flat tops out here, the jeep carriers, which Kurita mistook for fleet carriers. Okay, he knew he couldn't compete with fleet carriers. He had only a surface force. He had no aircraft carrier, and you know, airplanes by that point of the war could easily sink a surface force. So Kurita had the Yamato, he had about six heavy cruisers, he had a very powerful force. All the Americans had were these jeep carriers, which are basically Liberty ships with a deck on them. They had like 18 planes on them. They didn't have any armor. They were very easy to sink. And they had a few destroyers, couple of cruisers, and a bunch of PT boats. That was all they could do. So Kurita could have sailed right through that, you know, not been affected by them at all, and completely disrupted the landings. But this is where the complicated battle plans fall apart. Kurita comes around the corner, and he mistakes the small American carriers for the fleet carriers. And he turns around and retreats and goes back up, and he could have completely disrupted the Philippine landings of the American forces. So anyway, there are just so many things that can go wrong with a Japanese battle plan when it gets to be that complicated. And obviously, you can also see that the forces are all divided here. They're not capable of reinforcing each other. This was also true of their land attacks, by the way. They had all these feints and all these little nuances and stuff that were supposed to throw the enemy off. On the subject of offense, one thing that I rarely see discussed is the infantry weapons. And I can't talk about all of them. We'd be here all day. But the Arasaka Type 99 rifle, which was a standard Japanese infantry rifle, It was basically a copy of the turn of the century German Mauser, 1898 Mauser. It was a bolt action rifle, single shot rifle, had a clip. Can't remember how many shots it had. It was either five or six. But the point was that it was a bolt action rifle. So you sit there and put your clip in, you pull the bolt back, you push it down, bam, you fire. You pull it back, push it back down, ejects the former round, puts in a new one, bam, you fire. Okay, and so it's like this, bam, like that, bam. It's, you know, the fire's about every 5 seconds, and that doesn't let you aim much. You compare this rifle to the one the Americans had, which was the M1 Garand. The M1 Garand was a semi-automatic rifle. It used the blast of the shell of the cartridge you just fired to load the next cartridge and eject the old one out of the chamber. And so it was a semi-automatic rifle. Every time you pull the trigger, the thing fired. So you go bam, 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 like that. You know, compared to the Japanese, which are sitting there with the bolt. And this was basically the rifle they had right up to the end of the war. In fairness, the Japanese did have one really good infantry weapon, the Nambu light machine gun type 11, which was every bit the equivalent of the Browning light machine gun, which the Americans had. The Americans had the Browning air-cooled light machine gun. The Nambu was really good. They called it the woodpecker. The Americans called it the woodpecker because it sounded just like a woodpecker. If you know what, I can't imitate the sound of a woodpecker, but you know what that sounds like. It's just that rate, and it sounded just like a woodpecker pecking away at a tree. Okay, also on the subject of defense, again, the theme comes in that the Japanese didn't seem to think anybody was going to be shooting at them. So in the design of their planes, I mean, this is war, right? I mean, it happens. But in the design of their, in this case, planes, on the top is the A6M0, which was a Mitsubishi plane. The A6M0 was a late 30s design. It was designed in 1937. The engine was a 14-cylinder Sakai radial made by the Nakajima Aircraft Company, and it had 950 horsepower. Now, 950 horsepower may sound like a lot, but it's not when you're trying to do what you're trying to do with a plane. So the way the Japanese got the performance out of it was they took all possible weight out of it. They took the self-sealing tanks, which weighed about 600 pounds, by the way, the self-sealing tanks, they took them out, okay, so that, I'll tell you in a minute why that matters. And the armored pilot seat they took out. Half the pilots didn't even carry parachutes because that was a fairly heavy piece of gear. They did everything they could to make the plane light. So the plane had incredible performance. I mean, the range of it was unbelievable. The Americans couldn't believe it. The maneuverability of it was unbelievable, and all this stuff. The climb rate, you know, the performance was just tremendous out of this 950 horsepower engine. They ended up having a 1200 horsepower by the end of the war, but when it really mattered in the beginning, it was this 950 horsepower Sakai. This is the same size engine that the Americans had in the P-40, which was the Warhawk that Claire Chennault and the Flying Tigers used in China. The P-40 had a reputation for not being that maneuverable and that good in a dogfight. Well, the reason was that the Americans went for survivability. It had a 950 horsepower Allison engine in it, which obviously an American engine, but it was a much heavier plane. The good news was that the pilots tended to survive. So in these early dogfights with the F-4F, which was the Grumman Wildcat, see, I haven't got time to go into all this stuff, I'm sorry, but the F-4F, which was a Grumman Wildcat, and the P-40, the Japanese would pump round after round, and they only had, by the way, 30 caliber machine guns, which were kind of puny. They did have a 20 millimeter cannon, which was really good on the Zero. But they pump round after round in the Americans, and the planes wouldn't go down. I mean, they could get on their tail really good because the Zeros were very maneuverable, but they couldn't get the American planes to go down. The Japanese, on the other hand, without the self-sealing tanks, for one bullet. And Americans learned to fire tracer rounds, by the way, which is like a phosphorus, you know, it's like an incendiary round. They fire tracer rounds. One tracer round hits the wing of a Zero, and that thing catches on fire or blows up. And that was it. So the Americans had the self-sealing tanks and the armored seats and all that. So this is one way that the Japanese lost a lot of pilots early in the war. And these were experienced pilots, been fighting in China and all that. By the Battle of Midway, which of course is June 4th of 42, the Japanese had lost most of their experienced pilots. And that was only 6 months into the war. So they were in a world of hurt. The other plane that had the same issue was the G4M Betty bomber. This is the famous bomber that, for example, Yamamoto was shot down in April of 43. It had non-self-sealing tanks. It had two radial engines. It was very fast. The range of it was unbelievable. On paper, it looked like a Mitchell bomber. It looked like the B-25 Mitchell bomber on paper. But it wasn't. Here again, the Americans nicknamed it the Ronson Lighter because the thing just blew up with the first shell that hit it, the first round that hit it. Okay, on ships, the same general thing applies. Most of the Japanese ships were old. They were World War I designs, all right? Japan had not ever lost a war in their history. They had they were stuck with these World War I basically ships, which they had refit between the wars. But the Japanese, what a refit often meant was adding a pagoda mast. Here you got the Yamashiro on top. You see that mast? They call that a pagoda mast. Only Japanese ships had it. And I'm sure it looked really good in parade, on parade. It probably looked really good. But it made the thing top heavy, and it didn't add to the fighting value of the ship at all. Most of the Japanese ships, in fact, the battleships, the ones that were that the Japanese called battleships, were actually battle cruisers. In World War I, there was an English admiral who decided that you ought to put big ship, big guns on a lightly armored ship, which would allow it to be really fast and powerful. The problem was that the captains of those ships, battle cruisers they were called, forgot that they weren't on a battleship. They forgot. And so they go and they try to duke it out with a battleship and they sink. There were some famous cases in World War I where that happened. So most of the Japanese capital ships, with a few exceptions, were actually battle cruisers that had been, that the Japanese had upgraded to battleships. And this is an example of them. The thing that happened between the wars that nobody seemed to realize until, you know, militaries are always ready to fight the previous war, right? They're always ready to fight the last war. That's one of the dictums of military history. So they're always ready to fight the last war. So the Japanese ships would have been really good in World War I, right? But it wasn't World War I. And so the things that happened between the wars were that airplanes got much better. The airplanes could actually sink a ship. You know, World War I, they couldn't. They couldn't carry a big enough bomb to sink a ship, Billy Mitchell notwithstanding. They couldn't carry a big enough bomb to sink a ship. They couldn't carry a torpedo. None of that stuff happened, so the ships weren't that worried about planes in World War I or in the immediate aftermath. The other thing that happened that isn't generally appreciated is that fire direction and control, meaning aiming the guns of a capital ship, became much better by World War II than it was in World War I, which implied that you could hit a ship at a much greater distance. In World War I, the trajectory of the naval gunfire was almost flat. It was much flatter than by World War II. By World War II, it had a parabolic flight to it, and so it was coming down through the deck. And in World War I, they didn't have, the decks weren't armored. And so this is why I have a picture of the Hood here. HMS Hood, British battlecruiser, launched in 1921, World War I technology. In its battle with the Bismarck in the Denmark Strait, it famously blew up on the fourth salvo from the Bismarck because it went through the unarmored portion of the ship, hit the magazine, blew the ship up, sank, 2,500 guys on it, three survived. The last, Ted Briggs, died about 8 years ago, the last guy. But the ship broke in half. It was considered to be the most powerful ship in the British Navy, but people didn't realize all the things that had changed in the previous 20 years about ships. And so the Bismarck kind of brought that home to them. But the Japanese, and the reason I have it here is that the Japanese, most of their ships were like this. You know, when I first started studying the war, I couldn't understand how the Japanese Navy, which was the third most powerful in the world on paper after the United States and England, how it sank so easily, how the ships sank so without seemingly a lot of damage. Well, there's a few reasons, and one of which is that they were old designs. Another thing that the Japanese did, this is a Japanese carrier here, and the Taiho, which was a state-of-the-art, launched in the spring of 1944, Japanese carrier, basically the equivalent of the American Essex-class carriers. The Japanese only had one. They only had one carrier because they didn't have the capacity to build any more, and they were having trouble getting the materials to build it and all that. Notice that the side of the ship is solid. There is no ventilation for the hangar decks. The problem with the Taiho was they designed it for operations in the North Pacific. and they designed it so that it could withstand the wild weather that they occasionally had there. The problem is that in a battle, once again, the enemy might be shooting back. In a battle, the ship's going to take damage. So the Taiho fell a Philippine Sea in the summer of 44. Bella Philippine Sea, the Taiho is gets hit, you know, and it's sailing along, and nobody thinks there's a problem. But two things happened. One is that the ventilation fans for the hangar deck, which is the deck just below the flight deck, it's the one where they gas up the planes and put the bombs on them and all that stuff. The ventilation system for that deck was knocked out. And the other thing that happened was that several of the fuel lines were hit. And so fumes built up inside the hangar deck. So the Japanese are sailing along the next day. Everything's fine. Thing blows up. Just blows up right out of the blue. Blows up and is destroyed with almost 100% casualties. This could have been avoided. I mean, the Americans all had the ability to ventilate those decks by opening the side doors and ventilating out the hangar deck. But the Japanese, you know, did not. And this was something they easily could have avoided in the design of that ship. Another thing that the Japanese tended to do with their carriers was that the elevators were small. The elevators are what raised the planes from the hangar deck up to the flight deck. The elevators were small. So it took the Japanese a long time to get an airstrike off. All right. Now, if nobody's shooting back at you, it kind of doesn't matter. You can take your own sweet time. But again, in battle, sometimes the enemy's shooting back. Oh, lack of training and damage control. The Japanese considered damage control to be defeatist. Okay, this is a psychological thing. It implies that the enemy actually hit your ship. You know? And so they had minimal, the Japanese had minimal training and damage control. Very small damage control parties, very few guys trained, very little effort to that because it would look bad. It would look like they're expecting the enemy to actually, you know, hit the ship. And so what would happen is that if the guy that had the training in counter-flooding the ship or whatever, is more than one guy, but if that small party, you know, a bomb ran into him on the way to do it, then the ship was in trouble because nobody else knew how to do it. The Haruna, Kirishima, Hiei, and Kongo are examples of what I talked about earlier. These were battle cruisers that the Japanese upgraded to battleships. They upgraded them by changing the name from basically. I mean, they supposedly retrofit them, but it was very minimal, and they were not really battleships. They did this, by the way, with their light cruisers too. Japan had walked out, as I may have mentioned. I went through it pretty fast, but they basically abrogated the Washington Naval Treaty, or the London Naval Treaty. They basically announced they weren't going to abide by that anymore, and so they began upgrading all their ships without consideration to what those limitations were. So remember I said cruisers were limited to 10,000 tons. Well, the Japanese had 14, 15, 16,000 ton cruisers that they built just because they didn't feel like they had to abide by that anymore. And so the Haruna, Kirishima, Hiei, and Kongo were upgraded to battleships. A lot of the light cruisers were upgraded to heavy cruisers without really doing that much to them, other than changing the guns from 6 to 8 inch guns. Another thing that the Japanese did early in the war was they elected not to go with radar. The Japanese thought their eyes were superior to everybody else. And in the Japanese defense, early in the war, radar was pretty crummy. It's like any new technology. So early radar was really bad. This is what led to the famous event when Pearl Harbor was attacked. You had Privates Lockhart and Elliott out there on Opana Point, and the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor is coming in, and they spot it on the radar. They spot it, and it's a half an hour before the attack. And they called Kermit Tyler, who's the lieutenant on duty at Pearl Harbor, and Kermit Tyler says, don't worry about it. It's probably the B-17s coming in from the mainland. Nobody had any real faith in radar early in the war, and especially shipborne radar. And so the Japanese went with their eyes. Now, in their defense, they had really good optics. They had polarized binoculars and all this kind of stuff, and they could spot, they could actually spot the enemy farther away than the radar could pick it up. But as the war went on, radar became better and better, and their eyes didn't. Raw materials. It doesn't appear to me that the Japanese thought through what they had to do with this. This is 2,500 miles from Japan to the East Indies, the Dutch East Indies, which is what Japan needed to conquer to get rubber, tin, oil, all that kind of stuff that they needed for their industrialization. They didn't have enough freighters. It appears not to have occurred to the Japanese that anybody was going to sink their freighters. I mean, by 1944, the attrition rate in the freighters was just horrendous. And the Japanese couldn't get the raw materials to continue the war. Another thing that's kind of interesting, and you don't see this discussed too much, is the lack of mechanical ability. Japan had not been an industrialized country for that long. The Americans, for example, had been, and you had a lot of guys that knew how to work on cars. They working under the shade tree of the, you know, on the farm or whatever. They work on a tractor, whatever the heck it is. The American Sherman tank, for example, had Chrysler engines in it. Had a Chrysler, about half of them, not all of them, half of them, had Chrysler engines in it. The American guys knew how to work on a Chrysler engine. It wasn't the same engine, but it was the same basic principle. They knew how to work, knew how to fix it. So when the thing breaks down in the middle of nowhere, the Americans can devise a field expedient, we used to call it in the Marines, a field expedient, to get the thing going. It's called baling wire and chewing gum. The Japanese did not. They had to train all these damage, these repair parties, and hope the guy didn't run into a bullet, you know, on the way to fix whatever the heck it was. The other thing the Japanese didn't do, and this may have made some sense actually, was they had almost no pilot training program. They put all their best pilots out in the beginning and figured, I think, that they had to win the war, had to be a short war, may as well put your best guys out there, because if it's a long war, you're going to lose anyway. The Americans pulled a lot of their best pilots back and had them train the other pilots during the war. So as the war went on, Japanese pilots got worse and worse. The Americans got better and better. And so by early 44, it wasn't much of a contest. And this is why Ozawa had all the carriers with no planes on them. They'd all been shot down. So victory disease, hubris. The Japanese went in having never lost a war, didn't think they were going to lose this one. Didn't occur to them that they could lose the war. You haven't read World War II history until you've read the diary of Admiral Motomi Ugaki. This was Yamamoto's chief of staff. He lived through the entire war. He flew the last kamikaze mission on August 15th. And his diary starts in 1937. He's one of the guys that planned the early invasions of Southeast Asia. And he went through the entire war. He was shot down with Yamamoto in April of 43, but he lived. He was in the other G4M bomber. Yamamoto was in the other. They had what they called, the Japanese themselves called, victory disease. They got very sloppy, the Japanese. They got very sloppy in the first 6 months of the war. They had nothing but victories. The Allies weren't prepared really for war. The Japanese kind of knew it was coming, so they were prepared. So they just won all those early battles around Java and all that early on. And they just thought they couldn't lose. And so this is one of the things that led to their demise at Midway. But it didn't occur to them that the Americans were working on their codes. And this is one of the relatively unappreciated aspects of World War II. The codes were, the fact that we had broken the Japanese codes was a classified fact for 50 years after the war, which had some kind of long-term consequences. So the Americans are working on the codes. So here we have Nomura and Kurisu, the two Japanese ambassadors, and they're going in to see Cordell Hull, and they're going in to declare war on the United States, okay? This, unfortunately for them, was an hour and a half after the Pearl Harbor attack. The Japanese had intended to declare war 30 minutes before the attack happened, which wouldn't have given the Americans any time to do anything about it, 30 minutes before. Well, the Americans were better at decoding, translating, and printing out the Japanese transmissions than the Japanese were. So the Americans already had the whole thing in Cordell Hull's hand by the time the Japanese ambassadors showed up. And so it was a famous speech that Cordell Hull gave. It was one of the delicious, he had time to prepare it. Never in all my 50 years of foreign service. It was great. So here they are, and it didn't occur to them, like I say, that the Americans already had it. Well, as I said, the fact that we broke the codes was classified for 50 years. But the Japanese didn't know it. And as the war went on, the Japanese did not have the ability to change the codes. If you think about what changing the codes meant, that would mean they'd have to transport a code book to all the different islands that they had, which they had to physically transport it. Obviously, you couldn't broadcast a new code book because Americans are reading the codes, so you couldn't broadcast it. So you had to transmit a code book. And the Americans controlled the ocean by that time. The Japanese Navy was basically on the bottom of it. And so they couldn't do it. They couldn't change the code. But early in the war, they could have. And if they had, the American war effort would have been set back seriously. The only reason we won the Battle of Midway was because we were reading the codes, which I'll get into in just a second. But the Japanese didn't occur to them that we were reading their codes. I mean, no disrespect to the Japanese Navy, but it just, when I'm reading about it, the Japanese have these incredibly complicated and, you know, just nuanced battle plans, and they it doesn't occur to them that the Americans, why the Americans would show up at just the wrong time. They're sailing out there, flags flying, they got all these ships and all this, and they can't possibly lose, and just at the exact wrong time, the American fleet shows up. You know, and so it kind of reminded me of Professor Fate and Max. So breaking the codes, how did we manage to break the codes? There was a guy named Lieutenant Commander Joe Rochefort, who lived in Palos Verdes, by the way. He died in 79. He lived in Palos Verdes. And he had a code-breaking effort at Pearl Harbor called Station Hypo. There were five guys in the basement. I've been to this place. The building's not there anymore, but it was a cinder block building, and he was in the basement. It was dank, and you can imagine how a basement would be at Pearl Harbor. I mean, it was wet, and it was a miserable place. Code breaking was considered to be kind of not ethical, almost. I mean, you know, what's his name? Stimson said, "Gentlemen don't read other gentlemen's mail," and so they kind of looked down on code breaking. But Rochefort was working on it. And in the 6 months before Pearl Harbor, he was working on the codes. There were two Japanese codes. One was the Purple Code, which was a diplomatic code, and the other was JN-25, which was a naval code, Japanese Admiral's Code. And so the declaration of war that they intercepted and translated, and we saw Nomura and Kurisu a minute ago, that was in the Purple Diplomatic Code. That was a lower-level code. That was easier to break. But the JN-25 code was a pretty high-level code. So by Pearl Harbor, they were doing what they call traffic analysis. They didn't have the code totally broken, but they did traffic analysis. Every ship had a telegraph operator on it, and he had a particular style of transmitting. They called it a fist, the guy's fist. And you knew what ship that guy was on. And so you could tell what kind of was going on, if that ship was very active, and then you also knew what other ancillary ships were with that ship when it was, you know, like, let's say it was the Yamato or the Japanese carriers or whatever. You kind of knew what was going on. And so that's how they knew something was happening at the time of Pearl Harbor. Nobody thought it was Pearl Harbor. They thought it was the Dutch East Indies. They thought it was the Philippines. They thought it was anything but Pearl Harbor. But it turned out to be. So Joe Rochefort is working on this, and there's, in a couple of months before the attack on Pearl Harbor, there were tons of messages, and they had five guys, and they couldn't go through them. So they stack them up on a bunch of desks along the side of the wall. Okay, my dad knew all these guys, which I'll get into in a second. But they stack them up on the side of the wall, and so the attack happens, and among the ships that are sunk are the USS California. This is the California about 2 days after the attack. You know, it's kind of good as a side, I mean, good, a little bit of silver lining to the attack, that it was a surprise attack, because had Kimmel known, the American admiral, known that the attack was happening, he would have sorted the fleet out into the ocean, and it would have got sunk in 2,000 feet of water, and we wouldn't have recovered any of those ships. As it turns out, we got six of the eight battleships back in action before the end of the war. So the harbor is only 45 feet deep, so you could refloat those ships. So only the Arizona and the Oklahoma didn't survive. So here's the California. And during the attack, it took two torpedoes in the port side. And so here it sits on the harbor floor. The reason the California did not turn over like the Oklahoma, and it had almost the same damage as the Oklahoma had, you know, the pictures of the Oklahoma upside down and all that. The reason it didn't was that one of the junior officers on the deck was named Jackson Ferris. He was a Lieutenant JG in the Navy. And he was in charge of damage control, and he happened to be on duty during the attack. And he got together a damage control party, went below and counter-flooded the ship so that it settled straight down in the water. Otherwise, it would have turned over like the Oklahoma. He obviously risked his life and that of his underlings to do this. Here he is later in the war getting the Congressional Medal of Honor from Truman. Jackson Ferris also lived in Palos Verdes, by the way. I'm not sure how all these guys end up in Palos Verdes. I ran track with his kid at Palos Verdes High in 1963. Tells you how old I am. But anyway, so here he is getting Congressional Medal of Honor. So the USS California Band has nothing to do The ship is sunk. They got nothing to do. Rochefort needs more guys to go through these messages. So he says to at that time, Admiral Pai, who had taken over from Kimmel. Of course, Kimmel was immediately fired when the attack on Pearl Harbor happened. Takes over, asks Admiral Pai, give me the guys in the California band, because they got nothing to do. They can't fight. They're musicians. They can't, you know, they're not going to throw their clarinet at the enemy. And so he gives them the band, 65 guys, or 45 guys. He gives them the band. He sets the band to work going through all these messages stacked on the next to the wall. Well, one of the things they find out as part of this is that the musicians, you guys are all, they're incredibly good at this. They're incredibly good at cryptanalysis, which is code breaking, and they're incredibly good at learning Japanese in kind of a crash, ad hoc, OJT kind of a way. And so, you know, this is, by the way, how the Navy found out the connection between between language and musicians, which I'll get into in just a second. So they go through all that, and the Battle of Midway, which happened on June 4th of 42, was triggered by, and I'll get to why the codes matter in a minute, but was triggered by the famous raid of General Doolittle with the B-25s taking off the Hornet. The Hornet was the only way they could get the B-25s close enough to Japan to actually reach the islands. The B-25 was a land-based bomber. The Japanese couldn't figure out how the Americans had done this. What island had the Americans taken off from to bomb Tokyo? You remember the movie 30 Seconds Over Tokyo, or I think it was it 30 or 60 seconds? Anyway, some number of seconds over Tokyo, that movie. That was about the Doolittle raid. So the Japanese said, well, we've got to, you know, he overflew the Imperial Palace. They bombed sacred Japanese soil. We got to make sure this doesn't happen again. And so they devised the plan for the Battle of Midway. Americans had to either take off from Midway, or they had to have taken off from the Aleutian Islands, one of the two. So the Battle of Midway was going to be a way to, A, keep that from happening again, the bombing of Japan, and also to wipe out the American fleet. So they send one admiral up to the Aleutians to take that, which he did, and the other one was was going to invade Midway and take it, and after that, the Hawaiian Islands. So here we have this, and it led directly to the Battle of Midway. There is the Makuma. This is one of those heavy cruisers the Japanese had upgraded on paper. This is a result of it after the Battle of Midway. It wasn't in all that good a shape after the battle. So what happened was Rochefort, this is where Rochefort really earned his stripes. Nobody knew where the Japanese were going to attack. The Japanese had two-letter abbreviations for all the islands in the Pacific. And there was this AF kept coming up, AF. Nobody knew what AF was. Kimmel thought it was Pearl Harbor, or Kimmel, by that time it was Nimitz, thought it was Pearl Harbor. Another guy thought it was the Panama Canal. Nobody knew what AF was. So Rochefort has this ingenious plan where he sends a message to Midway on the underground cable, a secure message saying, broadcast in the clear tomorrow that your desalination plant is broken down and you're short of drinking water. Broadcast it in the clear like it's an emergency. So right on schedule next day, Midway broadcasts in the clear that their desalination plant is broken down. And right on schedule, a message goes to the Kido Butai, which was the fleet that was going to invade Midway, telling them, AF is short of drinking water, and so bring extra drinking water. And this is how they figured out it was Midway. And so the Americans only had three carriers left. They didn't have any battleships. They had a bunch of cruisers. They managed to put the fleet exactly where it needed to be, northeast of Midway, and ambushed the Japanese fleet, which is how they won the Battle of Midway, which was definitely the turning point of the war. I mean, it was going to be some turning point because Americans were certainly going to win, but that was definitely it. Japanese lost four carriers in the space of 2 days, three of them in 10 minutes, by the way, and they never recovered from that. And they lost all the planes by definition because the planes didn't have anywhere to land. The carriers were all at the bottom of the ocean, and they lost most of the pilots. But that was all due to the code having been broken and knowing exactly where and when the Japanese fleet was going to be. The shoot down of Yamamoto, also in April of 43, was another one. This was after the Battle of Guadalcanal. The Japanese troops were starving. They were demoralized, and Yamamoto was going to go down there and buck them up. And so the Americans intercepted his plans, intercepted his itinerary, and they had 16 P-38s go down there and intercept him over Bougainville and shot him down. So the Americans figured out that there was a connection between being a musician and code breaking. Americans had nobody that spoke Japanese. They felt they couldn't trust the Japanese, the American Japanese, the Nisei. The Americans set up a Japanese language officer school in Boulder, Colorado. And this guy, Lieutenant Commander Hindmarsh, went around the country to select 150 guys to learn Japanese in the spring of 1942. And they had to be Phi Beta Kappa members, and they had to be musicians. So one of them was my dad. And this is a picture of them at Christmas break in 42. In the middle is Roger Pino. Three guys to the right is my father. Roger Pino was my dad's best friend during the war, and he ended up being a pretty famous guy. Rigid top-down command and control. This was another way the Japanese shot themselves in the foot. The Japanese did not have a tradition of the junior officers and NCOs taking over when the senior guy goes down. They just continued with whatever the orders were. But here we have Guadalcanal. This is a perfect example. This is when the Japanese were still, you know, August 7th of 42 is when the Americans invaded Guadalcanal. And the battle lasted about 6 months. But in late November of 42, the Japanese were frustrated that they hadn't been able to wipe out the Marines. So they sent the Ichiki detachment, who had been with the Kwantung Army in China as one of the crack units of the Japanese Army. The Ichiki detachment, 1,000 guys under Colonel Ichiki, transport them down there, and they are going to annihilate the Marines. The Japanese battle plans always call for annihilating the enemy, by the way. It's always part of it. And so they do. And so this is the famous Battle of the Tenaru River. You heard of the Battle of the Tenaru River with the Marines? Well, this is what it was. It was actually Alligator Creek because the Marines' maps were wrong. Battle of the Tenaru River. So the Ichiki detachment is going to charge. And this is part of the victory disease thing. They didn't do anything to keep their attack a secret or silent. When I was in the Marines, we used to have to put tape around our slings so they wouldn't rattle and stuff. And we used to, you know, all this different kind of stuff. Not them. They're drinking sake. They're singing. They're walking along the beach with their, you know, making all kinds of noise. So the Marines know they're coming, right? And they set up on the other side of Alligator Creek with the Ma Deuces, you know, the 50 caliber machine guns. They set up, and the Ichiki detachment charges into them on the beach, and they wipe them out to a man, all 978 of them. But, you know, they had died gloriously in battle, so that kind of, you know, served that purpose. But they were wiped. But the thing that was amazing was that General Hayakataki, who was the Japanese commander on Guadalcanal, you know, the Japanese had a terrible time delivering bad news. They had a really bad time delivering bad news. So his assessment of the attack was that the attack of the Ichiki detachment was not entirely successful. Okay, well, here they are. I mean, you think? It was they were wiped out to a man. In April of 43, the Japanese evacuated Guadalcanal. This is Cape Esperance on the right here. This is where they evacuated them right here. It was actually a pretty good evacuation. The Americans didn't know what was going on. Americans show up, going to attack them. Japanese are gone. It was a little like Dunkirk. I mean, in a way, they very skillfully pulled it off in the dead of night and all this. So pussyfooting, it's kind of like the attack of the Ichiki detachment wasn't entirely successful. When Emperor Hirohito broadcast his surrender message to the Japanese people, which, by the way, none of them could understand because his style of Japanese was the imperial style. It was a very stilted kind of style, and none of them could understand it. In his speech, his assessment of the war was, and this is after Nagasaki, this is after Hiroshima, this is, you know, Japan and Tokyo had been burned out. The war situation has developed not necessarily to Japan's advantage. Okay. I mean, this is, you know, pussyfooting around. I mean, that was the understatement of the century, or at least my nomination for it. On the right are the Japanese POWs on, in this case, Saipan. My dad actually took this picture on Saipan listening to the surrender speech. Here's the surrender delegation aboard the Missouri in Tokyo Bay. A few notable people here. In the middle with the cane in front is Foreign Minister Shigemitsu. This is General Umezu, who was the only Army officer they could get to sign the instrument of surrender on the right front here. And this guy right behind him is Kase. This is the interpreter. This picture I have to put in just for personal reasons. This picture came out in all the major dailies across the country in late 1944 as the Japanese atrocities early in the war began to make the news. And it was to contrast the way the Japanese treated their prisoners with the way the Americans did. So this picture is taken on Saipan. This is my father, right here on the left, giving a glass of water or whatever it was to this little Chamorro girl. It says it's a boy and it says it's Japanese, but it's not. My dad said it was a Chamorro girl that he was trying to keep from crying. But the most interesting part of this picture is this guy behind him, leaning over. This is Miguel Tenorio. My dad rescued Miguel Tenorio from the Japanese, who killed his parents. And Miguel Tenorio became the governor of the Northern Marianas in the 1980s. A couple of things I want to clear up. First of all, there's a lot of conspiracy theories about the Pearl Harbor attack. I'm here to tell you the Americans did not know Pearl Harbor was going to get attacked. So you can just lay that one to rest. There is no way that they knew. The fates of husband Kimmel and Walter Short, the admiral and general in charge of Pearl Harbor, respectively, they were scapegoats. The administration needed to appear to do something about it. Most of the fault for the fact that the Pearl Harbor attack was a surprise lay in Washington with the messages that they sent and didn't send. We could talk about that probably all day. But that's pretty much the conclusion I've reached, and these two guys were the fall guys. Last thing is the detention camps. There's been a ton of misunderstanding about this, largely because the fact that we had broken the Japanese codes was classified for 50 years after the war, as I mentioned. Remember I said that at Station Hypo, they had all these messages before the war. I didn't have time to go through them, and they stacked them up on a desk. So the USS California band's going through the messages, and the other guys that know more what they're doing going through the messages. By January, when they, you know, now we're at war, we got to really get cracking on this, they discovered a series of messages to the Japanese consulates around the country and to the embassy, instructing them to set up sabotage rings, primarily on the West Coast, to bomb the American defense plants. Okay? They came across a series of messages that were, and they didn't know whether they'd been successful or not. And so Roosevelt issued Special Order 9066, rounded them up and locked them up, all 110,000 of them, into detention camps. And, you know, there certainly was racism involved and all that sort of stuff, but the actual reason was that they discovered these messages, but they couldn't tell anybody at the time because they couldn't let the Japanese find out we'd broken their codes. So in conclusion, I have to say, having studied this for many years, that the Japanese probably did the thing that, from their perspective, made the most sense. That's basically my talk.
Thank you for watching Peninsula Senior Lecture Series. I'm Betty Wheaton. See you next time.